Obviously, you'd going on tour, doing a tour.
And I am.
Can we talk about that first?
Yeah, sure.
So what can the audience expect? I mean, I know, so we all know about your history. We all know about what you've done. But
well, I always say that if you're the kind of person that enjoys these 10 minutes that come along at the end of a programme that tell you a bit more about how they were done, then take my show is an expanded version of that. But it obviously roams across several shows, several of my experiences underwater, topside, in the poles and in the tropics, and also for some of the other stuff that I do. You know, while I have a name or a face with the wildlife, I've been filming for the last 35 odd years, and in that time I've done commercials and travelogues and science documentaries and things like that. So there are stories from all those, as well as a long-term perspective over things like climate change. You know, I've worked a lot in the poles, and so I've seen the changes for myself. So all that lot is wrapped together in what I hope is an entertaining but informative couple of hours worth.
So it's all pro dog, it's all about, you know, everything you've done, like your experiences on the TV and all the film, and also before as well, your history about why you how you got into this sort of industry.
Yeah, that sort of stuff is covered. And I always have a lively Q&A session at the end of it where people can ask me whatever I want. Now, I can guarantee that there will always be a few people come to the end and say, you've got a dream job, how can I do it?
Yeah.
And I get everything from 14-year-olds to 45-year-olds that have going through a midlife crisis coming up with that as well. You know, but I'm happy to give out any advice that I can to anyone.
Yeah, you've hit the nail on the head there, because I'm 46 3 days ago, so I was going to say, and also my daughter's inspired because she's seen all the blue planets and everything, basically.
Yeah,
she's 11, so you've hit the nail on the head where you said about me and her, I guess.
Well, you know, I mean, it's certainly for the youngsters, it's a wide open world out there. There's more wildlife getting filmed at the moment than anywhere else. And me, I'm not sure, I'm entirely self-taught.
Okay.
I started off on stills when I worked in the Antarctic, and it was a chance meeting with David Attenborough and a film crew way back in 1981. And I just worked with them for a couple of days, and I thought at the end, boy, this cameraman is doing everything that I like. He's travelling, diving, working with wildlife, etc. And so despite the fact that I hadn't picked up a movie camera at that point, I thought, well, I taught myself still, so let's go in the movie.
Yeah.
And admittedly, it was simpler in those days, technically, but there we are. So I'm very happy to, you know, talk to your daughter if she feels that way inclined, perhaps give her some useful advice.
Yeah.
But everybody who's working in the business, you know, kind of got into it in their own particular way.
Yeah.
Anyway, it's all possible.
But so you just, like you said, you weren't sort of trained in anything to do with wildlife or algae university. It's all by being tenacious, by just being that chance encounter meeting David Attenborough and the film crew.
Well, I think, you know, it's interesting. My father was a photojournalist.
Okay.
But I don't think that particularly rubbed off. Well, I think the thing that rubbed off with him was that he always seemed to be going to interesting places, admittedly just within Scotland, so to speak.
Yeah.
But he was always coming back with stories of meeting so-and-so, or maybe going down the mine to do some pictures down there, or maybe up in a plane to do some aerials. Mm. So there was always that element of exciting, interesting, unexpected sort of stuff dealing with him. And when you combine that with definitely a love of being outdoors, not wildlife as such, but I knew when I was in secondary school that wherever I worked, it would never be in an office. and that combined with a real interest in diving through the 60s, that took me to marine biology at school, at university.
Yeah.
But I decided at uni I didn't want to be a scientist. I wanted to help scientists, you know, collect the data. Collecting the data underwater, that was where all the fun and adventure was.
Yeah.
So I did that, and then ended up in the Antarctic, and that was where the photography bug took hold, and then David and the whole thing kind of fell into place. So I would say, if I had to summarise, it was just really building lots of interests around a core passion for diving and adventure. And I'm going to say it's been, you know, I don't consider that I've had one job for the last 35 years. Every shoot I do is slightly different, and some of them draw on all the experience that I've got. And other ones, it's time for, you know, something new, some new technique that's being required. So it's good fun. Like I said, I haven't just done wildlife, I've done travel documentaries, science documentaries, even commercials. I don't know if you remember the one that was running last year where Zoopla, little hermit crabs with houses on them.
Yes, yes.
Well, I filmed that one.
Ah, right, okay. Which, oh, well done, brilliant, brilliant.
Well, that was an interesting one. They had the good sense to, they wanted to do it for real.
Yeah.
But they really looked into it and into how to build the houses, how to get the hermit crabs into them without stressing them.
Yeah.
And then also, to be honest, get me on board, who at least knew that you can't really direct a hermit crab. But it was good fun because I was down on my knees. The good thing about that was that normally when we go on a wildlife shoot, there might be three people there, maybe four. Maybe, but 3-2 is not uncommon. Well, there was 44 on that shoot.
Okay.
By the time you added everybody up, it was a kind of typical commercial where everybody's there to cover individuality. And there was obviously a lot of just waiting around, lying around on the sand, waiting for the hermit crabs to move in a certain direction.
Yeah.
But it was good fun. We had everybody was very understanding about me and about the crabs. And I think they thought it was a bit weird, really, seeing it all for real. But it's okay. It was 10 days in Costa Rica.
Wow.
Working with nice subjects and good people.
Yeah. I want to go there one day, actually, in Costa Rica. It's meant to be an amazing place.
It is a remarkable place. They say it has more diversity of habitats in Costa Rica for its size than anywhere else. You've basically got the Caribbean on one side, the Pacific on the other, and a range of mountains up the middle. And it's different east to west and from high to low. It's a bonny place, yeah.
Oh, right, okay, I'll take that on board then. I will go then. But you know, like you said earlier, you said you're going to be talking a bit about climate change on the tour.
Yep.
I mean, you've been all over the world. You've been to the both poles many times. Mm-hmm. You know, you've witnessed these. I mean, a lot of people when they read newspapers or say watch the news, they may think, oh, they don't sort of believe it. But because of you yourself, who's been there, you know, and done that and actually witnessed it, what have you seen? What sort of damage? I mean, is it as real as what they say on the news?
Well, I mean, it is real, and it's real within UK. And I mean, you take that hurricane that's just gone through the Bahamas.
Yeah, yeah.
While we've always had hurricanes, the intensity of the hurricanes and to some extent the frequency that they're arriving has been heightened by climate change. Hurricanes take their energy from the difference between the heat of the water and the heat of the atmosphere.
Yeah.
So if we're heating the atmosphere more than we're heating the sea, because there's always a time lag, and that's why we're getting more intense hurricanes.
Right.
UK, you know, the flooding that we've had, the 1 in 500 year floods that we've had 2 or 3 times in the last 10 years, you know, those are linked to climate change, and we're not seeing it as extreme here as for example, in the poles, the North Pole, the Arctic is the most rapidly warming place on the planet we're talking about. I've just come back from Svalbard, which is a bunch of islands up in the north.
Yeah.
The Svalbard winters are 4 and 5 degrees warmer than they used to be. And the pattern of ice movement, ice formation, ice melting round about Svalbard is being much less predictable than it used to be. And the Arctic itself, I mean, I started off working in the Antarctic, British Antarctic Survey back in 76, but I started going to the Arctic back in 1988, and that was the end of a sort of stable period. We didn't realise at the time, but the Arctic has changed a lot in the time that I first went there. As I say, the pattern of ice movement, things like that, and that is radically affecting the animals that live there, because, funnily enough, if you went to the North Pole, you know, sat above the North Pole on a satellite and looked down, you realise that the Arctic is actually a frozen ocean surrounded by land. You know, the nearest point of land to the South Pole is Greenland. That's about 600 miles.
Okay.
But then you're round by Canada, Alaska, Russia, a whole lot, and Norway to some extent. So, and that giant freezing ocean, or that ocean that should freeze over in the winter and then melt at certain times in the summer, that is now melting at a rate of knots. And we've also, recently, we've been learning a lot about Greenland.
Yeah.
The rate of Greenland is an ice cap. It's like an island underneath, but with a huge, solid, you know, 2,000 metre thick ice cap on top of it. Well, there's been more melt in Greenland this year than any previous year. And You know, the whole Arctic is very, it's a big weather controller. What goes on in the Arctic affects the weather all round about the Northern Hemisphere. Mm. And we now have sufficiently sophisticated weather modelling that we can link some of the monsoon patterns, for example, and droughts in different parts of the world at excessive rate. We can link all that to changes that are happening up in the Arctic.
Mm.
So it's big, and you know, as I say, not only have I been going there on a fairly regular basis myself, but I've made a lot of good friends up there, particularly among the Canadian Inuit. And talking to them, they would tell you, and albeit in a non-scientific way, but they'll tell you that things are changing. The whales aren't coming back the way they used to.
Mm.
The berries are coming into flower sooner than they were. And so, you know, big changes are happening up there. And part of the tour, I think, is
awareness.
People think gurus are definitely becoming more aware now than they were. I mean, to be honest, we had a big bulge of conservation interest in the late 60s. You know, I remember when we were all the Save the Whales campaigns, and Small is Beautiful, all that sort of stuff.
Yeah.
And you really thought, because I was just graduating at that time, you really thought that we're going to look after things. And then somehow for 25, 30 years, we really lost that impetus to look after things, and we turned to using the natural world and worldwide trade, etc., etc. You know, really took off. It was a big spurt around about the mid-80s when China suddenly came on stream. And now, you know, for the past 20-odd years, people have been saying, look, things are changing, and we're going to change the way we do things. Well, now, finally, in the last 3 to 5 years, we've seen people becoming aware of that. And the frustrating thing is that people have been, scientists, et cetera, have been talking about the changes and saying we should do things
for years.
Since the late 80s, early 90s, and it's only when things are so bad that we finally decide to do something about it. Well, I do see some solutions in the long term. They won't be cheap, they'll be expensive, but there are some solutions out there.
Okay.
The key thing is to swing them into effect soon.
And you think he's gonna? I'm a big, you know, I'm all for, you know, and it's just, I only raised the question before when I said about, is it too much truth in it? But it's just, you get a lot of people will say, oh, well, I don't believe that, you know, a lot of the Americans especially, they would be very, very, you know, you know, it's ridiculous, isn't it?
No, there should be no grounds whatsoever for any form of climate scepticism.
Yeah,
I mean, you've got to believe the science, and you have to believe what's causing it. You know, those things are pretty much unequivocal, I would say.
Mm.
The challenge now becomes that to confront those issues and to begin to solve them, there are many ways of doing it, and which ones we adopt and how fast we adopt them, well, has to some extent got to do with your political persuasion and how much, you know, governments make it. I mean, as long as we keep putting, you know, money and cost of doing something as their bottom line, then we're going to be too slow. But, you know, the cost of, I mean, the cheapest way in the world to generate electricity is undoubtedly through renewables. But if it wasn't for the fact that we've got so many oil-fired and coal-fired power stations in the world, which still have 25, 30 years of life in them, and people are determined to use them for that life, we could decommission them all tomorrow, and with a giant subsidised push towards solar power and wind power, we could make a hell of a difference in the next 3 to 5 years. But it's all about political will and having governments that will do that. And I have to say, if they all stand there together and wait for one or the other to act, and let's have a big, you know, somehow let's all act together instead of countries saying, I'm going to do this now, it's just, then, well, you know, it's like trying to get big agreements between people. We live in a very complicated, tied-up world in terms of trade and all the rest of it, and contracts. And a lot of these just need to get chucked out the window and start again.
Yeah, and the thing is, Doug, it's all about greed, isn't it? Governments have to make all the money. It's all down to money.
Well, Well, it is how they make all the money. As I say in my talk, on the other hand, when you look back to big mega projects in the past, there have been several examples. I mean, going to the moon was the simplest one.
Yeah.
You know, when the Americans decided that they wanted to go to the moon and they had to be before the Russians, you know, 500,000 people nearly were employed on the Apollo project, and it cost them $80 billion, and they did it.
Yeah.
If you look even more recently, when things were all going completely haywire over the banks, we found $2 trillion in a few months, you know, to bail them out.
Yeah.
So if the need is perceived as great enough, the money can be made available and can be made available quickly.
Mm.
And I think that's what all this Extinction Rebellion and climate strikes and things like that. We need to listen to these people. We need to recognise that if we don't do something, then we're going to, I mean, the cleavage up the country has been bad enough for Brexit, but if the cleavage up the country goes into those who really want to do something about climate change versus those who, for whatever reason, choose to delay or not to, then that's a much bigger split between people than anything else.
Yeah.
So I think it's about persuading people, nudging people, but at the same time, we need confident political leadership to take us to this new place.
I think, it's like you say, we need good political leadership, but I think, do you believe it can be done, though? We can sort of prevent it getting worse than it is. Do you think it's doable?
I don't know if we can prevent it from getting worse, even if we turned around tomorrow and turned off all the CO2 going in. There's a certain lag effect, but we should be doing all we can, because the idea of that I've heard, even, you know, the government has this climate change committee, and what they're called, maybe they have an overall committee looking at what we should be doing. Now, in that report, which I've read, they talk about if we don't do so and so, then we could have, you know, 3 and 4 degrees centigrade of increase in temperature.
Yeah.
Now, to talk about somehow living with that sort of change for human beings, that is just not going to happen. Right. You know, I mean, already we can see the sort of major disruption that's happening with just 1.5 degrees.
Yeah.
You know, the effect it's having on the insect populations, the bird, the whole natural world.
Mm.
If we start even entertaining the idea of somehow coping with 3 and 4, then I just can't imagine it. You know, so we definitely need to do something. But in a way, you know, look what happened to all the whales. You know, 150 years ago, we had hundreds of thousands of whales living in the world, and we stopped whaling, but there's no way that the whales are going to come back in the numbers and distribution that they did, because other animals have moved in to take their place, and the whole, you know, ecology of the ocean has shifted. So we can't bring that back, and if we do that sort of thing, or if those sort of big changes happen in every ecosystem on Earth, then I don't know what kind of a, you know, planet we'll end up living in. Maybe UK sitting there is, they do, I did read somewhere, rather ironically, if you want to live somewhere that might be the least affected by climate change, live between 40 and 55 degrees north or south of the equator. So the places to go to come to are UK, New Zealand, that kind of thing. You know, they might be, because we always have a variable climate, maybe that's a good place to go. But, you know, you just need to look at, I mean, imagine what would happen if the norm for summers in the Mediterranean becomes like it is. Nobody's going to go to the Med for their holidays, because it's just going to be too hot. And there's another thing happening in Mexico and the Caribbean. A lot of those beaches are being affected by a giant amount of seaweed that seems to be growing in the Southern Atlantic. And this stuff is coming ashore by the hundreds of tons, lying in big smelly messes. And a lot of people, you just need to go to your holidays once and have that, and you think never again. And that's on beaches which have got big 5-star hotels at the back of them that are relying on tourists coming to them.
Oh, I agree.
So
I was in Barbados.
You know, big shifts, exactly. Yeah, in the Barbados, you know, the Bahamas, Hurricane Service.
Yeah.
So, you know, we already live in very, we already are having to cope with extremes. events that we didn't expect to happen perhaps quite so soon. And if this is the norm, extreme weather events coming piling through, then we need to do something about it.
Yeah, because you just touched on it, because I was in Barbados about 4 or 5 months ago, and the locals were all saying about this stuff, and you say, what is that stuff coming in? Is it sand? And you think, no, it's the seaweed, like you said, and it stinks, and it goes all up the beach, and you have to sort of get rid of it, or what they do, they bury it into the sand, because there's so much of it.
I don't know, sometimes they bury it, sometimes they've taken it for landfill, but the latest that I read is that, you know, they're stuck with this for the conceivable future.
Jesus.
And that's a huge extra cost, and as I say, as you say, a holidaymaker only has to come across that once, and they think, well, I'm not coming back here again.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And that's it. You know, your economy's kind of got a major hole in it.
I know. I was wondering. You just reminded me. I was like, shit. Because I know the locals were saying it's not been happening for that long. You know, it's only been a few years or something like that.
That's right.
It's just coming off onto the sea, and it's just you see it coming in. You think, what is that? You think sandbanks, but no, it's not. It's bloody seaweed. And
they can see it from space, and they know where it's being formed, and they know that the ocean currents are just going to keep bringing it ashore. Maybe not all year, but sometimes. So all these sorts of stuff are all, you know, all big problems, and that's without also thinking about the major loss of life that you can have if, you know, sea level rises and it begins to take people out of Florida's one place, but the big low-lying poorer countries like, you know, Bangladesh, or even whole nations like the Maldives, which will just, they'll cease to exist.
Yeah, I know. It's such a shame. Beautiful place as well, so it's a beautiful place. Can I just mention about, I spoke to a guy called Dan O'Neill the other week. Do you know Dan O'Neill, don't you, from...
Go on, yeah. From...
Oh, no, sorry, he's a zoologist, he does a lot of presenting, he's attached to Hinterland, is it Winderland or something? Is it a film festival?
Wilderland, that film festival is doing the rounds.
Yeah, no, you're speaking highly of him. He said he'd worked with you or something, or you've done some filming for him on one of his projects or something.
I don't know if I filmed for one of his projects, but certainly I helped to get that idea of Wilderland off the ground, so to speak, and I was involved. I was one of the judges in the original competition, and then I introduced Daniel to my agent, who thought it had the potential to make a tour with the wildlife and things like that. So no, I'm glad that he took it up, because I think films like that are really, you know, that's where a lot of the talent starts from. The best way to get into the business is to show people what you've done, showcase your stuff, and it's tough to get on that broadcast program right away. But as far as filming is concerned, or editing, or indeed being a producer, if you can point to a finished piece of work and say, this is all mine, then that's a big leg up. So it's good to see that thing taken off.
Yeah, looking forward to it. It's coming to, it'll be in Wales in, I think it's October, November. So.
Ah, okay.
Yeah, so I'm going
to
go down
soon. As long as it's not on close to me on my nights, that's fine.
No, I think you are.
That's all the competition.
No, it's definitely not. So is there any place in the world you would never film? I know you've been everywhere, but avoiding obviously war zones, is there any place you would never go to? I mean, you know, within reason, you know.
I would never go, I don't know, I'm always up for new interesting places. I'm trying to think what's... I like to go to wild places, you know, I would like to go back to. To be honest, I'd like to go back to the Pacific Islands.
Okay.
You know, I did a few shoots out there. I worked in Tonga, French Polynesia, places like that. Yeah. And I've worked on some very small, remote islands. And I do like those for the reasons that the people, if there are people on the islands, then they're always very friendly and genuine and good people. And I like getting away from the crowd, so to speak, and I like working in places that are genuinely as wild as I can find them. So I've had a long run at the poles, so it'd be nice to try somewhere a little bit more friendly. But on the other hand, to be honest, on my bucket list of places to go is to spend more time in UK and Ireland.
Okay.
Because I think that's where I learned to dive, that's where I enjoy romping around the hills. And I'm not joking or exaggerating when I say that when things are But for a start, if you can go to the Cairngorms and take yourself and your tent up into the Cairngorms for a couple of weeks in February, you can manage anywhere. You'll survive anywhere. Likewise, if you go back to those same places in August and can stand the midges, you'll also survive anywhere. UK has a phenomenal range of scenery, and the fact that it's accessible but often difficult, you have to be patient, you have to be a bit tenacious, but it has the place that anyone, no matter what their age or abilities, can challenge themselves within that, whether it's a long walk or a dive or getting out to St Kilda, where it might take you 3 or 4 attempts to get there because it's so lumpy. And the scenery, when the mood of the scenery, okay, so it's not blue skies and stuff like that, but I often like the stormiest days, the windiest days, the days when the sun just pokes through a little bit of the cloud and the driving rain. Those are the ones that really are full of atmosphere, and you get lots of that in England and UK, and I like the fact that you have to work a bit to get the really special times to be on the top of the hill when the mountains are nice and things like that. So, you know, I love UK. I would also like to spend more time among the people of the Himalayas. I have some very fond memories of Nepal, not so much on a wildlife trip, but I filmed a couple of expeditions on Everest, and have some great Sherpa friends, and I loved walking up with her in Nepal. While I'm not a religious man, I know that if everybody adopted Buddhist views towards the wildlife and nature and was kind towards it in the way that they are, then how much different things would be. So I like that sort of part of the world too. South America is another favourite place of mine. You know, one language, Spanish, takes you pretty much throughout it, apart from Brazil. But those are highly favoured places. And in terms of places that I might not like to go back to, well, I had a very frustrating couple of shoots looking for snow leopards in Ladakh, which is sort of northwest India. And while, you know, again, the people were great, scenery was great, that animal was just a bit too elusive for me. I spent 11 weeks there in return for 1 hour when I could actually see an animal. I was asleep for 50 minutes of that hour, so it was hardly any award-winning behaviour. We got some stuff with a remote camera. We knew there was a rock that these animals visited and did some scent marking on it. So we set cameras up there and came back and got some shots there. But, you know, it wasn't, that's not the same as seeing it for yourself. So I was there in Mark Smith, another freelancer. He was out in Pakistan getting the stuff that really counted. He got the sheep getting chased across the rocks and jumping into the river. That was Mark's good work. I had to just hear about it over the radio. Mark's doing very well. That's just what I need to hear. Thank you very much. I'll go back to watching nothing for a few days.
It must be the boredom. I mean, I'm not saying it's boredom, but it takes a certain individual, doesn't it, just to sit, do that for 11 weeks, you know, just...
Yeah, well, you wouldn't be, you don't want to, you know, if you're the kind of person who's impatient, what have you. But on the other hand, it's a wonderful, marvellous privilege, and it really is to be given time in wild places. Yeah. And while it may be frustrating to not see the animal, you never waste time. I didn't consider that any of the time spent in the blind or walking around in the valleys looking, that was never wasted, because you just learn about the environment and you acquire a feel for these places. Mm. And, it's almost like, you know, as I say, being in Scotland or UK, it's good for the soul to have to work at things. And a lot of shoots are not successful. You know, when we did the original Blue Planet, there was something like, you know, about one shoot in five, you know, came back with nothing.
Yeah.
Because we were trying for... Hello?
Yeah, I'm here. Yep.
You know, one shoot in five, one shoot in four was unsuccessful because you're aiming high.
Yeah.
And when you aim high, things don't always happen for you. Right. And it's the same with all the series that go on now. Although I must admit that because the running cost per day with the very sophisticated equipment that goes out, the running cost per day of a shoot are higher than they used to be.
Right.
So, and also, to be honest, if we did the original Blue Planet, the ocean had a whole number of sequences in it waiting to get captured.
Yeah.
And in the 20 years since, those sequences have been picked off and improved on. So often, sometimes there are new stories that come up, but sometimes we go back and do things that we did before, but just in a better way, right, with different equipment that allows us to see the story in a different way.
Mm. Hello?
Hello, sorry.
That's right, he just sort of, no, I hear what you're saying, but it's like, you just said then, is that true then? It's like one every four and one every five shoots, nothing came back at all?
Yeah, pretty much. Oh, you know, that was for the original Blue Planet. Yeah. One of the toughest programs to do was for it? The original Blue Planet, yeah. One of the toughest environments was the open ocean.
Hmm.
The open ocean is a vast place, hmm, and it's very hard to hone in on where the action is going to be happening, and sometimes it's quite ephemeral.
Yeah.
And I do remember at one point where about half of the budget had been spent on this program,
right,
and they did what's called a pre-edit. In other words, they took all the material and said, let's cut this into sequences and see how much we've got. And they had about 12 minutes worth that was, you know, that was showing, and that was with half the budget gone. So there was a hasty reorganisation, and some of the programmes have been doing better than others. So money was plucked from different programmes and then put into the open ocean, and then it kind of had a lucky streak, a run of three locations that really did deliver,
okay,
and they managed to create the programme. But that programme was the most expensive one to do amongst the whole series. There was more money went into the open ocean, more time spent on the open ocean,
yeah,
than on any of the other episodes.
Right, okay, that's interesting to know. But then again, it's been out to sea years, probably would make sense, the cost, wouldn't it, I guess, because it's unpredictable, and there's also the logistics as well, getting there, you know, being out there. So.
Oh, yeah. I mean, it's a massive exercise in teamwork, bringing these things together. You know, the researchers find the stories, and then the producers decide which ones they want to try to do.
Mm.
They have to select the best time, the best team to go for it. Sometimes they try it once, get maybe half of it, and then they have to think, okay, do we go back next year and try it again, or maybe we've got as much as we need. And sometimes you go out and come back with nothing. Sometimes you go out thinking, I'll get 3 minutes worth here, and you come back with 5 minutes because this extra stuff happened.
Yeah.
So when you put it all together, and then meanwhile, the production manager and the production coordinators are sitting in the back saying, you know, do remember that, you know, we've only got a finite amount of money. So it's really all held together, and the good thing about working on the big series is that you're usually very experienced producers, and the camera people, I think, get the sort of best bit in a way. We're the ones who get to spend the time, maximum time, out in the wild looking for the animals.
Yeah.
But equally well, you need great editors and great producers after that, great producers to decide to send you there in the first place, but then great editors and producers to take the building blocks, so to speak, that we come back with and then craft them into a finished film. When every part of the process is on full song,
yeah,
that's when you get, you know, the whole is greater than the sum of the parts, so to speak.
Right.
Well, that's when you get a magic film made. You can't make a magic film without good footage at the basis of it, but equally well, that best footage, if you put it in the hands of a mediocre editor, then they just take the magic out of it. So there's a lot of skill and a lot of teamwork all the way through.
Mm. Well, no, it's the process. It's like I say, it's all, as long as all everyone's worlds of, you know, all the stars are aligning for everybody in the industry. You know, like I say, all it takes is one bad performance by a producer or an editor or whatever, just to make it everything just fall apart or not.
No, that's right. You can flat it out, but also, you know, it's important that you all get along as well, and that there's understanding on all parts. You know, we can't control the wildlife, can't control the weather. So sometimes when you go with the best will in the world and everything apparently looking good, you get there and the weather doesn't cooperate, something like that. It's important that you know that people maintain sort of perspective on it, and recognise that sometimes things just don't go right for no particular reason.
No, well, I think I've taken up more of your time anyway. We could talk all day. I've just realised I've got to get my daughter from school as well.
Get your priorities right.
Yeah, real. No, we talk about the real world, then we talk about the real world. If that makes any sense.
No, I know what you mean.
No, but no, I thank you for your time, Doug. Honestly, it's been a meal. Like I said, thank you for calling me. Like I said, I was trying you for about 10, 12 minutes and it was just nothing
at all. No, sorry, I know, man. I was just kind of away from my phone and things, but no, I'm glad I caught you.
Yeah, no, thank you, and I appreciate you. So I'll try and come and see you up in Truckee anyway when you're on tour. So.
Yeah, do. I'd love to see you. And, you know, come across and introduce yourself. I'm usually selling books in the foyer before it starts, and certainly at half time and things like that. So
okay.
Come on over.
All right, Doug, nice one. Okay, well, I'll thank you. Okay. Much appreciated. Thank you. And keep up the good work. Nice one, thank you.
Cheers.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye-bye.